In mid-November 2009, a young Moscow lawyer died in police custody. It was the latest twist in a dark tale of alleged fraud, corruption and intimidation, which has pitted my guest today against the Russian government. Bill Browder used to run a multi-billion dollar investment business in Moscow. Now he calls Russia a criminal state, which he is determined to confront. Has he picked a fight he can never win? Bill Browder, welcome to Hard Talk.
Thank you.
I want to start with Sergei Magnitsky. What was his connection to you and your Hermitage investment business in Moscow?
Sergei was a lawyer working for a firm called Firestone Duncan, an American law firm that we used in Moscow to advise us on taxes, regulatory matters, and help us sort of get through the labyrinth of complicated Russian legal system. Sergei became extremely important to us in 2007. 2007, our offices were raided by the Moscow police, and they took away all of the corporate documents that belonged to our Russian companies. And then all of a sudden, our companies were stolen from us, and through a very complicated scam, the taxes that we paid a couple years earlier, $230 million, were stolen from the Russian government. And Sergei's role throughout the whole thing was to help us try to figure out what was going on. It was too complicated for us by ourselves, but he was one of the smartest tax lawyers in Russia. And as he started to peel the onion, the whole picture emerged of what was happening, who was responsible, and how it was all being played out.
So Mr. Magnitsky was not part of your own company, but he was working pretty much full-time on your case.
Well, I don't know what other cases he was working on, but he was our outside counsel, and not the only outside counsel. We had four different law firms working for us, trying to help us figure this out. But Sergei was, I would say, a very central figure in the whole investigation, discovery, and then publication of the frauds that took place against us.
And on November 16th, he died in detention after close to a year behind bars.
Indeed.
What do you know of the circumstances of his death?
Well, let's back up a year earlier. As Magnitsky helped us unfold and uncover the whole fraud, he got more and more indignant that police and government officials could be involved in a fraud against their own countries. And as he became more indignant, in October of last year, of 2008, he went and testified against police officers who were involved with the fraud. And then 1 month later, the same police officers were involved with arresting him and then putting him into detention. So they stick him into detention. And in prison, they then say to him, here you are in prison. You can make life easy for yourself. Just sign the following false confession, confessing that you were involved in tax fraud and Mr. Browder, myself, were involved in tax fraud.
Coercing him to testify against you.
Against himself and against me. And he said no.
How do you know that they were asking him to do that?
Because he wrote it in various complaints to the prosecutor saying I'm being pressured. And every time they pressure me and I refuse, they put me in worse and worse conditions. So he went into one detention center, they put him into a worse detention center. He went into, and then they pressured him again, a worse detention center. At that point, about sort of 6 months into his detention, he started to develop very serious abdominal problems. He had pancreatitis and gallstones. And the prison hospital said, you need constant treatment, you need ultrasounds, and you may need surgery. And he was very concerned. He had lost about 40 pounds at this point. He had gone from being a quite boisterous man to being a quite frail man. And at that point, they transferred him to the notorious Butyrka prison. This is the place where the worst prison...
That's a maximum security facility.
A maximum security facility and very, very harsh conditions. And in Butyrka, they stopped allowing him any kind of medical attention when he had a very serious medical problem with all this stomach ailments. And that's when things really started to go wrong. And the reason that we know things started to go wrong was because he documented every day, every violation, everything that he asked for, which was in his rights, that was denied, he documented in a complaint. He spent 358 days in prison and wrote more than 400 complaints.
And through his lawyer, you knew he was in dire straits. You knew the situation for him was getting worse. How did you feel when you got the news that, far from just being very ill, he had died?
It was like a knife through my heart. I can't even begin to describe the horror of hearing that news. It was the worst thing I've ever heard in my life. It was just awful.
It sounds brutal, but the truth is that he would be alive today, would he not, if he had not become involved with your very tangled business affairs in Moscow?
Well, he got involved. He was like any other professional. We hired him to work on our case. And had he not gotten involved, this wouldn't have happened. Having said that, though, there's one important thing to understand, which was that it was clear that there was trouble for all the lawyers in the summer of 2008. And the police started to go around and try to arrest all of our lawyers, not just Magnitsky. And we warned all of them, get out of Russia.
Did you help some of your immediate staff, that is, who are working for Hermitage, at any point after you first ran into trouble with the Russian authorities in 2005, when they barred you from re-entering Russia to conduct your business, at any point over those following years when the situation got more and more difficult in this confrontation with the Russian state, did you take any of your staff out of harm's way, actually take them out of Russia because you felt it was too dangerous?
We took all of our staff out of harm's way, and we took
including
all...
Including Russian staff?
Yeah, including Russian staff, and we took all of our lawyers out of harm's way.
And do you, in retrospect, feel you perhaps should have thought wider? You should have thought about lawyers who were working on your behalf, confronting the Russian state, who were actually employed by other legal firms.
We did. We did. We pulled them all out. And I asked Sergei to come out as well.
You asked him to come out?
I asked him to come out.
And his response was?
His response was, I didn't do anything illegal. There's nothing for me to come out for.
Because you knew it was very dangerous, didn't you? I mean, I've been looking back at the record. You talked about Russia becoming, quote-unquote, shark-infested waters. I believe that lawyers working for you had been beaten up by the police.
And we pulled them all out. I have something like 7 lawyers who left the country that are here in the UK that we got them sanctuary. And I asked Sergei to come out as well. But Sergei believed that there was a law in Russia, that you can't just be arrested for nothing, stuck in jail and tortured to death.
Looking back on it, is there more you could have done? I believe at one point a member of your staff got a phone call or a text message on the phone which quoted words from The Godfather. If history has taught us anything, this ominous message said, it is that anyone can be killed.
Yeah.
At that point, you must have thought that this suggests the threat to people involved in your case in Russia was very, very serious.
Indeed. That was about 10 days before Sergei was killed.
And as I say, looking back now, is there anything more you could have done to save his life?
Well, we tried doing a lot of things. We tried doing a real lot of things. I went and testified in front of Congress. We went to the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, who did a study into the whole situation of our lawyers, and particularly Sergei Magnitsky, and issued a unanimous resolution against what was happening. I went to the Parliament here. I went to the International Bar Association, who wrote to Medvedev. I went to the Law Society, who wrote to Medvedev. We wrote letters to every single member of Medvedev's Anti-Corruption Commission. We were powerless. I mean, basically, you had a bunch of murderous people torturing the man. What can I do?
Do you think you pushed too far in the end? I mean, you were determined, even though you were no longer living in Moscow. In fact, to be frank, you were sitting in the safety of London or wherever, financing a legal case, a fight with the Russian government, which you knew was going to get very dirty. Do you now feel you pushed it too far, too hard?
Well, you know, I've been thinking a lot about this, but the one thing that I can tell you is that in October of this year, a month before Sergei died, he took all of the allegations that we were pushing and made them directly to the court about the police officers involved in the fraud and involved in the $230 million tax theft. If Sergei was...
allegations, it has to be said, this has never been...
It's been proven.
It's never yielded convictions in a Russian court.
It has indeed. It has indeed. They actually convicted a sawmill foreman for the whole thing.
Yes, but
this is not allegations.
What I meant was convictions that you regard as credible, because you don't regard that as credible.
Well, but a conviction, the crime was the crime, and we can argue about that. But let me just say very clearly that if Sergei Magnitsky decided to go into court while he was incarcerated and to accuse the officers of $230 million tax theft and the theft of our companies, then I would have been letting him down if I hadn't pushed it as hard as he was pushing it.
The question is, did you want to push it harder than he did?
The question was, if a wrong is being done, how do you deal with it? And some people walk away and some people stand up to it. Sergey was someone who stood up to it. I'm the kind of person who stands up to it as well.
And I know, consensus in this interview, and I've read the stuff you've said in recent days, I know the anger this has roused in you and the determination.
Hitting wind.